Erin Kay Pospisil. Erin has been missing since Sunday, June 3, 2001, from Cedar Rapids, Idaho. At the age of 15, Erin left her home at 8:45 p.m. to go to her friend Britt's house to watch movies. It was the very first day of summer vacation, and the two girls were planning a third friend's surprise birthday party later on for the next week. Erin was able to hitch a ride to her friend's house with a friend of her older brother, Curtis, who was leaving at the same time that Erin needed a ride. When they arrived at Britt's house, however, nobody answered the door. It would come out later that her friend had made a quick run to the grocery store. As Erin walked back to Curtis's truck, a dark-colored Chevy Cavalier, or Chevy Impala, with tinted rear windows pulled up at the curb. Erin stopped at the car and clearly knew whoever was inside. She walked back to Curtis, telling him that she would get a ride with these guys. She got into the back seat. She hasn't been heard from since. 3 days later, Erin was reported missing to the Cedar Rapids Police Department. Since the friend who witnessed her departure said that Erin seemed to know the people in the car, the Cedar Rapids police made a decision to classify Erin as a runaway, as is their policy, which requires proof that she did not run away. Absent anyone hearing a scream or any other physical proof she was taken against her will, means for all intents and purposes, the police will treat her as a willing runaway. Her family's problem with this theory is that Erin had an obsession with a day timer that went with her everywhere, and she left this behind. Erin also had multiple friends that she never went without talking to, and she spoke to no one ever again. Not only did she not take her day timer, but she left behind other important things like makeup case, backpack, clothes, and every bit of her belongings. Early leads suggested her disappearance could have been related to gang activity in the area, but those leads went nowhere. Only one possible reliable sighting came in the spring of 2002. Erin was believed to have been spotted at a convenience store in Cedar Rapids. She was riding in the back seat of a car with Illinois license plates. This tip was provided to the Cedar Rapids police by a person who knew her well and was positive this was her. The car was not found. As of today, Erin is still listed as a runaway by the Cedar Rapids Police Department. She is listed as the only person missing in the section of Current Unsolved Crimes webpage. There have been numerous attempts to get her classification in the Cedar Rapids database changed to halt the classification of her as a runaway. Her mother has been very vocal about their refusal as being unacceptable. Regardless of the circumstances, all kids like her should be considered endangered missing. Because of this classification, it was nearly impossible for her family to get attention or press coverage at the time Erin disappeared. Like so many other kids, it's dependent on law enforcement's reaction to a child's disappearance. It didn't help that it predated the Amber Alert in Iowa by 2 years. The best that they could do was some news reports over time as more and more time passed. They did manage to get an article in the local Gazette 20 years after her disappearance as a form of a feature on runaway teens. If Erin is still alive today, she would be 35. If you have any information on her case, please contact the number on your screen. Heather Nicole Kullorn. Heather vanished in the early morning hours of July 15, 1999, from Richmond Heights, Missouri. At the time, Heather was babysitting in an apartment complex there. In July 1999, 12-year-old Heather was staying with her mother's friends, Dana Madden and Christopher Herbert, at their apartment in Richmond Heights. She had been staying at their residence for 2 weeks, helping out as a babysitter for the couple's 2-month-old baby. Dana was working the night shift at a convenience store, and Christopher was at a party, though his actual whereabouts have never been confirmed and his story has changed many times. Around 4 a.m. on the morning of July 15th, Christopher returned home from his partying to find his 2-month-old daughter alone and crying uncontrollably. He claims he was unable to find Heather anywhere, but instead of calling the police, he called his girlfriend. He argued with her briefly, and it was her who called the police. Investigators arrived at 5 a.m., finding no signs of forced entry in the apartment. Inside was a lot of blood on the couch, which DNA identified as belonging to Heather. Along with Heather, a white comforter with a floral design was missing from this apartment. From the beginning, the police believed that foul play was involved, and they did not believe that she was a victim of a random abduction, rather that she knew her attacker. Dana and Christopher were the main suspects, although Dana had a rock-solid alibi. The apartment itself was not considered safe. It was well known to police for drugs and partying. While searching the apartment, police found drug paraphernalia in the basement and also evidence that a meth lab had been there at one time. Investigators immediately turned their attention to a methamphetamine ring in Missouri and began to theorize that Heather may have witnessed something she wasn't supposed to see. In April 2000, 9 months after Heather disappeared, her mother, Christine, had a verbal confrontation with Dana during her shift at the 7-Eleven in St. Louis. She accused them of withholding from the police and knowing the whereabouts of her missing daughter. While begging Dana to tell what she knows, she was arrested by the police for refusing to leave. The Mississippi River was dragged in hopes of finding her body, but nothing was found. Because Christopher's accounts of what happened that night kept changing, it's possible that one or both of the couple do have information they are withholding. Although she had troubles with her rebellious daughter in the past, her mother wants everyone to know that Heather would never have run away or left on her own. The biggest trouble she had with Christine was finding her smoking cigarettes. She was a cheeky adolescent with a huge heart. Shortly before she was abducted, she had been diagnosed with type 1 diabetes and was learning to manage her illness. Police say it would have greatly affected her in the hours she was missing from the apartment. Heather was 12 years old at the time she went missing in July 1999. She was looking forward to entering middle school and planned to be a nurse someday. If Heather is still alive, she would be 34. If you know anything about her whereabouts, please call the number on the screen. Leigh Marine Occhi. Leigh was born on August 21, 1979 in Honolulu, Hawaii. Her parents were Vicky Felton and Donald Occhi. They were military members who met while stationed in California. Eventually, they divorced and Vicky relocated with Leigh to Tupelo, Mississippi in order to be closer to her parents while her ex was relocated to Germany. Growing up, Leigh was known for being kind and loving animals and pizza. She especially loved horses. She exhibited symptoms that are known today for signs of ADHD, and they led her to have some problems in school, as well as between her and her friends. In the summer of 1992, she was just 13 years old and about to start 8th grade at Tupelo Middle School. Her boyfriend, Jordan Morse, attended a different school and they spoke daily by phone. That final day, Vicky left for work at a nearby manufacturing company, leaving her daughter home alone. Vicky called home not long after she arrived at work that day to warn her daughter that the weather was going to get worse. However, Leigh did not pick up the phone. Vicky left work at 8:45 a.m. to check on her daughter. She reports finding the garage door open and the front door unlocked. A search of the home revealed blood smeared on the walls, on the door, in the bathroom, and no sign of Leigh. After checking the backyard, Vicky called the Tupelo Police Department to report her daughter as missing 15 minutes later. This time lapse would be questioned later on as there was blood inside the house. The door not only contained blood but also hair, as if she had been thrown into it or she fell. The police believe that Leigh hit her head during a struggle. Another strange thing is that her bloody nightclothes were found inside of a hamper. Bloodhounds were called to the scene, searching the perimeter around the house. But due to the difficult weather conditions at the time, the dogs were unable to pick up any scent or alert to what might have happened. Aerial searches were done, but no sign of Leigh was ever found. Her father promptly took leave to come and try to search. He had a strong feeling from the start that Vicky was involved. She did not cry and her demeanor was odd. This was further fueled by local residents who told the father to look at the mother. It did not help that Vicky failed 3 different polygraph tests. Her father and stepfather passed theirs and were ruled out as suspects. According to Vicky, a local man named Oscar Mike Kearns is responsible for Leigh's disappearance. He was a vacationing Bible school teacher and he had contact with Leigh. He was later convicted of assaulting a different girl. On September 9, 1992, an envelope containing Leigh's glasses, the only things that were missing from the home, arrived with a postmark from Boonville, Mississippi. The popular belief is that this was meant as a red herring to change the course of the suspicions against her mother. The person who mailed the glasses has never been identified. Many local residents openly theorized that Vicky was involved in her daughter's disappearance. Rumors were abound regarding her alleged abuse toward Leigh, with classmates saying that the young girl would sometimes arrive in school in a somber mood, marked with bruises or black eyes. Vicky maintains her innocence. Leigh is currently classified as endangered missing. If alive, she would be 40 years old today. Please contact the Tupelo Police Department at the number on your screen if you have any information on her case. I hope you enjoyed today's missing stories. Please hit the like and subscribe button if you haven't already. Take care of yourselves and each other.